you there. You have very clearly indicated requirement to have a very effective land doctrine to cater for the future challenges of Sri Lanka. In that, he had initially elaborated on the strategic locality of Sri Lanka and how we should formulate our land doctrine to face the future challenges. He had been talking about the 15 components that should be there for multiple layers of complexity of issues that we need to cater in the future. And also, he had been talking about the point that the traditional and current social values should take the lead in founding the land doctrine. And also, the experiences that we have gained during the colonial era and also the post-independence, especially from 1971 up to date, the experiences that we have gained is of much importance whilst we are formulating our land doctrine. With that, I will now introduce the second speaker. He is Rear Admiral Dimuthu Cyril Gunawardhanan. He is going to deliberate on the security challenges faced by an island nation in pursuit of a maritime hub. Admiral Dimuthu is presently holding the appointment of Commander, Northern Central Naval Area at Thalaimanna. He joined the General Sir John Kotalala Defence University, then Academy, in 1982. He was commissioned into the executive branch of the Sri Lanka Navy in January 1986 upon successful completion of his basic naval training at the Naval and Maritime Academy, Trincomalee. In the academic arena, Rear Admiral Gunawardhanan was graduated from the University of Colombo, Sri Lanka with an honors degree in Bachelor of Science in 1985. He possesses Masters in the field of management from the General Sir John Kotalala Defence University and Osmania University, Hyderabad, India. He has followed National Security and War Studies course in National Defence University in Pakistan. He is also a distinguished alumnus of the PLA Naval Command College, Nanjing, China, and the College of Defence Management, Hyderabad, India. The high aggregate he obtained for his sub-specialization in communication in India in 1993 stands as a record even to date. During his naval career spanning over 30 years, Rear Admiral Dimuthu Gunawardhanan has commanded fast attack craft, fast passenger craft, and fast gunboats until his sea career culminated in 2008. After relinquishing command of SLNS Samudra. While he was in command of SLNS Samudra, the ship was appreciated thrice, once by His Excellency the President and twice by the Commander of the Navy for the invaluable contribution she made during the humanitarian operations. Further, he had served as the Deputy Area Commander South, Deputy Area Commander Northwest, and the Commandant of the Naval and Maritime Academy in Trincomalee. Rear Admiral Gunawardhanan's distinguished, decorative, and unblemished naval career has been rewarded on several occasions. In recognition of his competent and valiant performance at sea, he has been awarded with Gallantry Medal Rana Vikrama Padakkama on three occasions. He has also been commended 5 times in his career by the Commander of the Navy for outstanding performance of duty and exceptional contributions to the naval service. Rear Admiral Gunawardhanan is an all-boy of St. Thomas's College, Mount Lavinia. He is married to Nalika, a professor in the field of community medicine at the University of Medicine, at the Faculty of Medicine, University of Colombo. And also blessed with 2 daughters, Dilisha and Mahesha. Over to you.
Thank you very much, sir, for a kind introduction. At the outset, I too want to thank the Commander of the Army and the Commander of the Navy for giving me this opportunity of addressing this August forum. Distinguished delegates, both home and abroad, ladies and gentlemen, good morning. The sequence of my presentation is as flashed. I would first like to define what a hub is. A hub, as defined in the Oxford Dictionary, is the center of an activity or region. Obviously then, a maritime hub would then be the center of a focal point of maritime activities. In Mahindra Chintana, Vision for the Future, the development policy framework of the Government of Sri Lanka, His Excellency the President has spelled out his vision in transforming Sri Lanka into a dynamic global hub by year 2020. Let me quote, "The objective of our next massive leap forward is to transform Sri Lanka into a strategically important economic center of the world. My determination, therefore, is to transform Sri Lanka to be the pearl of the Asian Silk Route once again in modern terms. Using our strategic geographical position, effectively, I will develop our motherland as a naval, aviation, commercial, energy, and knowledge hub, serving as a key link between the East and the West," unquote. Sri Lanka has passed 5 years since defeating terrorism and ending the internal conflict, which is considered as the gloomiest era in the recent history of our nation. And now, the country displays a yearning to grab lost opportunities for economic progress. The long-term strategy of His Excellency the President for the country's development indicates the desire to join hands with other emerging economies and also transform the country to maritime hub in the Indian Ocean. The importance and value of the Indian Ocean is not only known within the region, but is a global secret. There is no better example than to quote Admiral Mahan, the infamous geostrategist and historian, whose prediction is as flashed. As you know, Sri Lanka is an island nation, and it was through sea trade that Sri Lanka was known and its history was shaped over the years. The Indian Ocean, which is Sri Lanka is located, has become the focal point of the 21st century. This has been predicted by historians, academicians, strategists, and statesmen, in some cases, a couple of centuries earlier. Economic globalization has further enhanced seaborne trade many folds, with 70% of global oil trade and 50% of the container traffic passing through the Indian Ocean, and thus the sea lanes have been aptly dubbed as the new Silk Route. The world economy, which is being connected by sea, has been a driving factor in this pivotal process. In rapidly changing geopolitical dynamics in the Asia-Pacific region, Sri Lanka's location has given prominence in the strategic dynamics of the major powers, thereby making it a gateway to East Asia and doorstep to South and Southeast Asia. If this unmatchable strategic location enjoyed by our country is harnessed, Sri Lanka could potentially be the focal point of shifting the strategic calculus from the West to the East. The world's busiest international shipping lanes, or the sea lines of communications, SLOCs, as usually called by seafarers, pass through the southern coast of Sri Lanka, just 5 nautical miles or 9.5 kilometers from land, and this geographical position has made ample opportunities and potentialities to make Sri Lanka an Asian maritime hub in the world, competing with other prominent hubs such as Singapore and Dubai. The main commercial port at Colombo is ranked 30th among the 125 ports around the world, and approximately 400 ships enter the port every year, and it's progressively moving forward to be the benchmark for this region with an increase in container handling capacity to 10 million TEUs, that is 20 foot equivalent units, by 2020. And thus, it will not be too far from being a shipping hub in the region once all three of its modern terminals are in operation, and not forgetting the thousands of employment opportunities it will create. Sri Lanka Ports Authority has recorded a growth of 12.3% TEUs in transshipment operations during 2013 compared to the same period in 2012. The deep sea port in the south, namely the Mahinda Rajapaksa port in Hambantota, located approximately 12 nautical miles in the shipping lane, will be a key service center and industrial port where large ships traversing could refuel. The port of Galle will also be developed as a yacht marina and a tourist destination. Meanwhile, Trincomalee, arguably amongst the best natural harbors in the world, will have a special economic zone, water sports, and will be an industrial port, while the port of Kankasanthure, or KKS, will serve as a connectivity and livelihood to the community in the north and east. Therefore, it is clearly visible that Sri Lanka is on the fast-track mode to gain global acceptance to its ports to achieve the status of a maritime hub. Having discussed the importance and progressiveness of Sri Lanka to become a global maritime hub in the world, let us now discuss the maritime security issues that the island is encountering and will encounter as it stands between the economic route between the Atlantic and Pacific regions. Given the huge volume of traffic, which is further likely to grow in many folds in the future, the volatility factor of the SLOCs will increase significantly. The increase in number of occurrences of conventional and unconventional maritime threats have raised fresh challenges to the sovereignty of the seas and maritime security missions to assume critical dimensions. Even revisiting the laws governing the containment of these threats has become necessary to achieve the desired objectives. I will now be visiting a few maritime threats that Sri Lanka could envisage in the following years while pursuing to be a maritime hub. Firstly, conventional maritime threats. As a hub in Asia, Sri Lanka will have to face with some unavoidable challenges, such as how to avoid being the focus of rivalry or competition among major powers. The Indian Ocean is a theater where the great naval powers seek to extend their power projection in pursuit of their respective national interest. India is the preeminent naval power in the region and has a vital role to play with regard to the future of the Indian Ocean. The USA also has an extremely significant naval presence in this strategic region. At the same time, it is apparent that the influence of China in the region is also expanding rapidly with its military modernization, its increasing naval presence in blue waters, and its expanding economic influence in countries of the Indian Ocean region. It is obviously that the safety and stability of the Indian Ocean is then critical for China's energy security, and its increasing interest and increasing naval presence in the region is quite understandable. It is important to stress that Sri Lanka is a small nation that is nevertheless very strategically placed at a critical location within the Indian Ocean. This has focused the attention of many powers on this country. However, none of these conventional threats of the states mentioned present an immediate threat to Sri Lanka, as it has always pursued a non-aligned foreign policy and our only interest is in our economic development. After having suffered for 3 decades of terrorism, the Sri Lanka people yearn for a better tomorrow. We welcome assistance from anybody who is willing to fund the projects that are necessary to unlock its economic potential without harsh conditions being attached. This should not be misunderstood as a form of alignment with any other country or the other. Maritime terrorism. A second grave issue that affects nations in the Indian Ocean literally is this. Time and again, terrorists have demonstrated their ability to exploit unprotected coastlines to cause havoc among nations. A study on maritime capable groups worldwide demonstrate that only a few armed groups have developed the capabilities to mount attacks on maritime targets. Most terrorist groups learn incrementally. Most groups are not innovative, but imitative. For instance, Al-Qaeda attack on USS Cole in year 2000 was a copycat LTT attack on Sri Lanka Navy ship Abitha, which was rammed by LTT suicide boat in 1991. Until the LTT was eradicated, the Sri Lanka Navy stands as the only Navy in the world to operate in a suicidal environment. During the 3 decades of terrorism suffered by Sri Lanka, the Liberation Tigers of Tamil Eelam, or LTT, smuggled a vast arsenal of formidable weaponry into Sri Lanka through the sea. This arsenal included heavy weapons such as high-caliber artillery, surface-to-air missiles, anti-aircraft guns, and other significant assets such as armored vehicles and light aircraft. They were stored in large floating warehouses off Sri Lankan forces, off Sri Lankan shores. Smaller vessels were dispatched to ferry these items from these floating warehouses to the coastline. The LTT also pioneered in placing sea mines of various types against both naval and merchant vessels plying in restricted waters around Sri Lanka. This modus operandi can easily be replicated by any terrorist group or non-state actors who have designs on nation's sovereignty and security. As shown today, there is greater connectivity between terrorist groups, and cross-border terrorist networks are operating across the Middle East, Central Asia, South Asia, and Southeast Asia. Use of the seacoast by terrorists to gain access to land for asymmetric warfare against state actors is also quite prevalent, and hence there is an imperative need to enhance the maritime and coastal security considering the proximity of sea lines of communication to Sri Lanka. Piracy. The menace of piracy is threatening the global maritime trade. Until 2004, the focus of piracy was on Singapore-Malacca Straits, and thanks to the initiation of a tripartite naval cooperation between Malaysia, Singapore, and Indonesia, an all-round operation was launched to ensure great safety for commercial ships that transit through the narrow Malacca and Singapore Straits each year. Now, one can be happy that incidents of piracy have dropped sharply, even in the Horn of Africa in 2012. This is due to multiple reasons: deployment of capital ships by various countries, convoys, changing monsoon, the improving situation in Somalia, and most of all, due to having onboard security teams, OBST. This is a practice we developed in Sri Lanka and mastered in mid-1990s during our conflict. We even proposed this methodology to UN in year 2009. Now, Sri Lanka has pioneered a legitimate public-private partnership in carrying out this operation. Sri Lanka, too, is playing a small but significant role in combating piracy. Sri Lanka's private sector companies, working through the Ministry of Defense, have provided onboard security to a large number of commercial shipping lines and fishing trawlers that operate in this region. Even though there is no any reported piracy actions in Sri Lankan waters, there are a number of incidents in Indian Ocean. Right now, there is no direct impact on Sri Lanka, but it affects the entire global trade, and thereby Sri Lanka also can be affected. However, an act to provide the suppression of piracy in Sri Lanka is in place since 2001 to legally deal with such offenders. Drug trafficking. Due to huge profits, drug trafficking has become one of the most lucrative and money-spinning means which is used to finance data networks and arms smuggling and trafficking. Due to proximity to Golden Triangle and Golden Crescent, Sri Lanka is fast becoming a transit point for drugs for the East and as the West as well. Heroin is routed via Sri Lanka from Pakistan or India on a big scale by sea, by containers and mechanized fishing craft. This sea route takes two forms: one from Pakistan to Mumbai, facilitated by underworld dons in the cities, then to Tuticorin or Rameswaram, and then to Sri Lanka by sea, or from Pakistan directly to South India. The money generated from the drug trade has also been linked to international terrorism. For example, it is known that the LTT used money raised from drug smuggling to fund its acquisition of weaponry to wage war against Sri Lanka. The wider impact of the drug trade requires nations to take a holistic and multi-pronged approach to the issue of drug smuggling, which not only affects a nation's health and domestic security, but can also have serious ramifications on the sovereignty of countries far away. However, Sri Lanka has been successful in apprehending a considerable amount of drug traffickers at sea in the recent years by Sri Lanka Navy. Human smuggling. The trafficking of persons internationally is another grave issue that affects nations through the sea. Every year, thousands of illegal immigrants are transported through international waters to other countries. This has had a major impact on the domestic policies and even the electoral policies of many nations. The nexus between human smuggling and terrorism is particularly worrying. After the military defeat of the LTT in 2009, its international shipping network began engaging in the illegal enterprise in earnest. Charging thousands of dollars per person, LTT vessels transported thousands of illegal immigrants through international waters to Western nations and to Australia. Not only did this allow economic immigrants to seek asylum in these countries under false pretenses, but even more disturbingly, it allowed trained terrorists to escape justice and pose a threat to the domestic security of the countries that they traveled into. More recently, even multi-day trawlers were used for the illegal transfer to Australia. In this context, I am pleased to report that the Sri Lanka and Australia have been working together in the recent past to stop illegal trafficking of persons to Australia from Sri Lanka. Bilateral dialogue has taken place at very high level, and operational cooperation through the sharing of information between the respective navies, coast guards, and law enforcement agencies has done a great deal to curb this trend. More recently, Australia gifted 2 Bay-class patrol boats to enable Sri Lanka to intercept asylum seekers before they leave Sri Lankan waters. As the operational cooperation between the responsible parties increase, I am confident that the threat posed by the trafficking of persons will be further curtailed, as flashed on the chart. IUU fishing. IUU stands for illegal, unreported, and unregulated fishing and includes all fishing that breaks fisheries laws or occurs outside the reach of fisheries laws and regulations. Fishing without a license, fishing in a closed area, fishing with prohibited gear, fishing over a quota, or the fishing of prohibited species are a few of them. IUU fishing has a tremendous impact on the sustainability of oceanic fish stocks as a result of overexploitation and wasteful fishing methods. The use of illegal fishing gear and practices such as bottom trawling can have major environmental impacts. IUU fishing depletes fish stocks, destroys marine habitats, distorts competition, puts honest fishers at an unfair advantage, and weakens coastal communities, particularly in developing countries. Some estimates are that illegal and unregulated fishing causes annual financial losses up to $23.5 billion worldwide and accounts for up to 20% of all of the wild marine fish caught globally. Sri Lanka too faces the challenge of IUU fishing in its exclusive economic zone, and many initiatives have been taken by the governments concerned to prevent foreign trawlers from encroaching into our waters, which is a lifeline issue for the local fishermen. This is particularly acute problem because it has a grave impact on the economic prospects of local fishermen, especially in the north and east of Sri Lanka, who are now rebuilding their livelihoods after decades of suppression under the LTT. The fact that these fishermen have to compete with such large number of fishing craft that illegally enter our waters have caused great tension and frustration in the newly liberated north and east, thus leaving room for creating instability, which will have an indirect impact on the country's vision to become a global hub in the Indian Ocean. Marine pollution. In pursuing to a maritime hub, many analysts are of the view that the biggest threat that the Sri Lanka waters face is the possibility of an oil spill risk that could severely affect the several key sectors of Sri Lanka's economy, such as fishing, tourism, port, and also cause major environmental damages. Sri Lankan sea is highly vulnerable to an oil spill risk as 25% of the world's oil transportation, which runs up to a quantity of 550 million tons per annum, passes via Sri Lanka's exclusive economic zone. The risk will increase further with the proposed maritime-based development projects in the country and also already functioning utilities such as the oil tank farm in Trincomalee. Another form of biopollution is ballast water, which may also pose a serious ecological, economic, and health threat due to the transfer of harmful organisms and pathogens in ships, ballast water tanks to our seas. These non-native species, when transferred, may establish in the sea, multiplying into pest proportions competing with local species. Befouling of ships is also a threat to the maritime environment. A single fertile fouling organism could release many thousands of eggs, spores, or larvae into the water with the capacity to found new populations. With enhanced shipping activities, Sri Lanka waters will be more prone to befouling. Other threats such as releasing of solid waste, debris, and other toxic materials from shipping activities could also generate adverse impacts to the environment, especially to areas such as shallow coastal waters and beaches where human use of these resources are inevitable. The Marine Environment Protection Authority, or short form MEPA, is the apex body which has been established under the Marine Pollution Prevention Act No. 35 of 2008. MEPA bears the sole responsibility to prevent, control, and manage the pollution of Sri Lanka's marine environment. National Oil Spill Contingency Plan, which has been formulated by the institution, is now being implemented with other stakeholder agencies as a response to any unexpected oil spill. MIPA, in collaborative with the universities, have initiated research activities to investigate the impact of ballast water discharge. It also provides waste reception service in 4 commercial harbors in Sri Lanka through the registered service providers. Natural disasters. A majority of the planet's natural disasters unfortunately happened to strike our region. The Great Asian Boxing Day tsunami of 2004 vividly demonstrated the level of suffering that could result from a mega disaster and the scale of humanitarian aid and disaster relief that such scenarios would demand. The port of Galle itself was the scene of devastation after the 2004 tsunami and serves as a grim reminder of the havoc that can be wreaked by oceanic fury. Navies are relevant here because they are the repository of capabilities like search and rescue, diving assistance, salvage and hydrographic surveys, which play a key role in the discharge of tasks such as humanitarian and disaster relief. Since no nation is able to stop these impacts, building resilience, adaptations and enhanced preparedness would be some of the best possible options to handle natural disasters. Disaster Management Center, which was established under the Sri Lanka Disaster Management Act No. 13 of 2005, is the apex body for planning, coordinating and implementing disaster management activities in the country. Disaster preparedness, emergency response, mitigation of impacts and recovery for marine-based disasters are in place. Among the many initiatives taken by Sri Lanka to meet these maritime challenges are enhancing maritime surveillance on land, inclusive major harbors, establishing of a coast guard in year 2007, acquisition of more ships with modern and sophisticated sensors and weaponry to guard our exclusive economic zone, making Sri Lanka a venue for maritime conference for information sharing, engaging in naval exercises with regional navies, participation in regional maritime initiatives to enhance regional cooperation, joint patrols in the international maritime boundary line. It is clear that individual nations acting in isolation will not be able to effect lasting practical solutions for any of these major maritime challenges. Without the sharing of intelligence and vital information and proper communication and coordination of naval operations, individual states will not be able to address this properly. The seas do not just make us all neighbors. They also provide unlimited opportunities for us to work together in a common cause, certainly in good times, but even more so when our neighbors need help. We must develop capabilities and linkages to work with partners from within and outside the region for the common good of our people. Sri Lanka, India, and Maldives have recently been working on a trilateral agreement for cooperation in carrying out surveillance and anti-piracy operations and in curbing illegal activities, including maritime pollution. In the years ahead, navies in the region, while continuing to protect respective national interests, will have to face a multitude of challenges as well in protecting their busy international sea lanes in the region. Inevitably, Sri Lanka Navy will be an active partner in the maritime security cooperation in the Indian Ocean region, especially due to the strategically vital location the country is situated. Greater cooperation and partnership between the naval powers in this region will benefit not only the nations in the Indian Ocean littoral, but the entire world, and enable all of us to face the future with confidence. Thank you very much.